The morning sun shines on the gleaming hide of a muscular ranch horse. The aroma of bacon and coffee drifts from the wood cook stove at a cow camp. Silver spurs jingle as the men and women of the West get set for another day in the saddle. From the heart of Canada's finest ranching country, this is the Spirit of the West with rancher and horse trainer Hugh McLennan and his collection of music, poetry, and conversations with the folks who live and work with horses and cattle in the Spirit of the West.
It'll be a little while before the grass is ready for the cattle, and there's still some snow around, and it shouldn't be too long before the brandings are underway around here. Gosh, I haven't healed a calf for nearly 3 years due to COVID and other things, and sure looking forward to it this year. And that brings up that subject on the Cowboy Poetry Spotlight.
He branded lots of cattle every spring. I often thought it funny that he didn't own a calf. But I kept quiet and didn't say a thing.
That's Red Stegall with a real head-turner today. And there's lots of good information on the Rangeland News.
COVID really decimated the industry, and now, just as things are opening up again for restaurants, the wholesale cost of the food they need to buy is rising.
And we have another great story from down in the vault.
So he rode back to the town of Ottawa, and he fired all of his predictors and his forecasters.
And you will hear from a real top hand from the brush country of West Texas today.
You went in there and come out driving cattle, and you had a little more going for you than a big hat and a pickup truck.
Yeah. Right.
That is the one and only Buster McLaury, and you'll enjoy what Buster has to say today, and he could probably identify with this song from another Texas rancher, Gary Prescott.
Riding for our brand back in the day.
with the bears. I once rode with the bears. Yeah, I once rode with the bears.
Buster McLaury can sure identify with that one.
Well, Buster, I wanted to meet you for a long time. I might know a little bit more about you than you know about me. Your wife is Cheryl.
Mm-hmm.
One of your daughters is Tiffany.
Yes, sir.
Right.
And our youngest daughter's name is Misty.
That's the other one. Yeah. Right. One of the first stories I read was something called Brush Country Cowboy and Western Horseman years and years ago, and I kind of followed your stories and your poetry ever since. And where was the place you grew up, and what were things like in your early days?
Well, I grew up there at 460's Ranch at Guthrie, Texas. My daddy was wagon boss there when I was born, so I grew up, you know, on those big outfits. And when I was about, well, I just turned five, and they promoted my daddy to foreman of another ranch they had just north of the 60's there, the Triangle Ranch. They were owned by the same people, and we kind of worked them as one outfit in the spring and fall, you know, when the wagon's out. So I just, when I was 10 years old, you know, I never thought anything about seeing 150 horses throwed up in the corner, you know, changing horses, or 300 or 400 cows in a roundup. I thought that's the way it was everywhere, because that's all I'd ever seen. So I grew up in that environment, and of course, them days we'd never heard of Ray Hunt. So, you know, every morning when you go leave the wagon, or anytime you change horses, there'd be at least one or two, might be four or five bronc rides going on as you left there. But them guys, they just rode them, and they went on and did a day's work on them. They didn't think anything about it, just the way it was.
Yeah,
that's the way we did it.
And sometimes, you know, once you get that colt's mind on following a cow or watching where he's putting his foot, it's amazing how fast they pick it up.
Yeah, it is. We give them a job to do. And we didn't know much about getting a horse ready in them days to do anything. So we just kind of went and did it, and a lot of them made pretty good horses anyway, in spite of everything we'd done to them.
Coming up, more from Buster McLaury and a song from a guy that he cowboyed with, when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. As we stood there next to Buster McLaury's big brown ranch horse, and by the way, you can see us right there on the YouTube version of this show, but as we stood there, we continued our visit.
What was the country like around there?
Oh, it's they call it the Rolling Plains. A lot of it's pretty rough cedar breaks country. All that country's real erosive, so there's a lot of deep canyons and places, a lot of rock. And then out on the more flat country, a little better soils, is all mesquite brush, so there's a lot of big mesquite thickets there.
I've heard stories about that stuff, but never rode anywhere near it. Mesquite cat claw and that kind of thing, that must be something.
Oh, yeah. Everything that grows out there got thorns on it. Yeah. Except the grass, some of the grass. We got needle grass and bear grass, and they both got thorns.
What about the roping styles on the 460's and the places where you grew up? Was it mostly short 30-foot rope and rubber on the horn, or were the long riatas and the slick horn kind of being used there?
Oh, no, it was all hard and fast. You didn't see any rubber on the horns till up in the late 70s, kind of team roping went to coming into our area, so you'd see some guys dallying on that. Out in the pasture, I never saw anyone dally, you know. And the only time I saw someone dally, I was a little bitty kid, and was Brandon in this old set of pens, and this cow jumped out. The fence wasn't too good. And several of them guys had their horses tied on the outside there, some trees and what have you. And anyway, everybody run and jumped over the fence, and this boy jumped on the horse, and Cactus Creek was just right there close, because it was just a jungle, you know. And so this boy runs that cow, and he roped her. Just as he got there, and he tried to dally with that short rope on that slick horn, and of course it just got loose from him. And I'd climbed up on the fence, you know, to watch. And my daddy was standing there looking, and he looks up at me, and he points his finger at me, kind of like it's my fault. He said, "You see there what that damn dallying's good for?"
Right.
So I didn't grow up with a real good impression of dallying.
Yeah.
But it just didn't fit our country.
Yeah.
Because, you know, that old brush and rough country, when you might not get opening, you know, from here to that post.
Oh, yeah.
You got a rope right there, and then you let 30, 40, 50 feet of rope run out there, and you got tangled up around seven different trees.
Yeah, right.
It'd be pretty hard to ever get back up to a critter.
Yeah.
And I can't tell you how many cattle I've roped in my life, and when we got things stopped, the cow would be out of sight behind a tree.
Yeah.
On 30 feet of rope.
Yeah, right.
Only 30 feet, but where is she?
Yeah.
Yeah, you know you got her. Well, it was kind of a blend where I first started doing a lot of riding for these outfits, and there were a few guys that did tie hard and fast, and a lot of dally ropers, but 40 foot was as long a rope as you ever saw. And one old fella I rode with for a long time said, well, I always tie hard and fast because you might have a wreck, but when the wreck's over, you still got your horse, your rope, and your cow, you know? And I still got all my fingers, he said. But this same fella, one time, we were sorting yearlings in a pretty big trap, and one of them got a little spooked, and he roped him, and just after he roped him, the yearling went out and he jumped a five-wire fence, and he's on the other side pulling his horse into the wire, and he got his knife out pretty quick. So I thought, you know, this dallying might not be a bad idea, too.
Well, we'll talk more about roping styles in a few minutes. And, you know, in the crew that Buster rode with, there was a cowboy who always packed a guitar in the wagon. And when the day's work was done, the crew would gather around as Fletcher Jowers would sing one of his original cowboy songs, like this one called The Saddle and the Ring.
I was just a young cowboy, in my pocket not a dime. Just a cowboy and didn't own a thing, except my cow horse and bedroll and granddad's old cack, but no money to buy any a gold wedding ring. When I rode out with the wagon, I'd sure make a hand, and that saddle I felt something like a king. But I mailed home my wages to mom and the kids, and I had no money to buy any a ring. Annie, I love you, you're my everything. I've sold my saddle and bought you this ring. A cowboy and his saddle never do part. But Annie, I love you with all of my heart. Annie was an angel admired by the men, and to her fancy treasures they would bring. It takes a special woman to become a cowboy's wife, so I sold my saddle and bought her a ring. Annie, I love you, you're my everything. I've sold my saddle and bought you this ring. A cowboy and his saddle never do part. But Annie, I love you with all of my heart. Still just a cowboy, and we have a family, but my love to Annie I still sing. She cried when I told her I love you, my dear, and I've sold my saddle and bought you this ring. Annie, I love you, you're my everything. I've sold my saddle and bought you this ring. A cowboy and his saddle never do part. But Annie, I love you with all of my heart.
Fletcher a few times, and I can just imagine what it would be like there, sitting around the fire, cowboys just hanging on every word of his songs. And now we'll get back to roping styles with Buster McLaury.
Oh, there's advantages both ways. Like I say, the dallion and or different styles of roping and different styles of equipment fit that part of the country. That's where it all come about. Yeah. You know, you see it mixing up a lot nowadays, but yeah. But those things evolved out of necessity. Like I say, it's what fit the country.
When did you first start writing for Western Horsemen? Because I can remember so many of your stories, being out with a wagon. One I reread recently, something about I don't really like dogs, or I don't like working with dogs.
I think the first article come out in 84. That sounds about right. It was along in the early 80s anyway. And the first one I wrote was that Brush Cowboy story, but I think the first one they published was on Brandon out to 460s.
Oh, yeah, right. And there's one of them mentions a good friend of mine from Texas I haven't seen for a few years now. His name is Fletcher Jowers. Did you ride with Fletcher's?
I worked with Fletch down at the 06 right there at Alpine. He worked through the wagon there, I think, one spring. But and of course, I'd known Fletcher around these poultry doings for several years.
Right. There's one line in there, something about when the day's work is done, and Fletcher brought out his guitar and sang some songs.
Yeah, he'd pick to sing a little around there. Some evenings, not every evening, but.
But that was kind of neat. And then that whole life out with a wagon, you probably spent as many years doing that as just about anybody that we talked to today.
I stayed at the wagon the first time. I was about 4 years old, and I could ride, but the old country was big and brushy and the cattle was wild, and so I couldn't stay up with the crew. So Daddy let me go and stay at the wagon and just, you know, kind of be, and I'd ride the wagon from one camp to the next and those kind of things. But it wasn't until I turned 5 that I got to going with the cowboys. But like things, you know, things get to happening pretty fast, and it's pretty easy to run off and leave a kid, you know. So, and they did run off and leave me some. So Daddy'd always tell me, well, just follow them tracks up or get out on top of the hill where you can see somewhere, and you'll make it. So.
A long ways between fences.
Yeah, long ways between fences. It's a big old country, and like I say, it's all rough and all brushy. And it was quite, if you went in there and come out driving cattle, you had a little more going for you than a big hat and a pickup truck.
Yeah, right.
Well, you'll hear more from Buster in a little while, and next it's a story from the vault that might have some implications for our politicians when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West.
Stories from the vault, from the Spirit of the West. This is where we dig deep for some of the most amazing stories from the folks who bring some heartwarming, knee-slapping, spellbinding episodes.
And Gerald Miller has this thought-provoking story.
This is a story that dates back to the time of Abraham Lincoln. I heard it many years ago, and I'm going to tell it to you. Now, there's this here king that lived in a town called Ottawa. And the king was a young fella, and he had a girlfriend that lived about 10 miles outside of town. Every once in a while, he'd put on his best clothes, and he'd go visit her. Well, one day, the king decided to go visit her, and he called for his forecasters and his predictors to come in and tell him what the weather was going to be like. Well, they forecasted, and they predicted, and they said, "Aw, king, the weather's going to be good. The sun's going to shine, you won't have any trouble." So he puts on all his fancy clothes and gets on his horse and heads out to see the girl. Well, he gets about halfway there and he runs onto this old fella coming down the road driving a mule. So the king, being a visiting sort of fella, stops to talk for a while. Now the old fella said, "Son," he said, "if I was you, I'd go back to Ottawa if I was you, because," he said, "it's going to come a rain." He said, "you're going to spoil your fancy clothes." King said, "Oh, no," he said, "you're wrong." He said, "I had my forecasters and my predictors out, and they said the sun was going to shine." Well, the old fella says, "Son, you see that mule of mine?" He says, "when that ear's halfway back," he said, "it's going to rain some. But," he said, "when it's flat to its head the way it is now, it's going to come a gully washer. You better go back." King said, no, he said, "my forecasters and predictors are never wrong." So he rode on his way. About a half an hour, it commenced to rain cats and dogs. It just poured and ruined the king's clothes. So he rode back to the town of Ottawa, and he fired all of his predictors and his forecasters, and he sent fellas out to find that mule. So he brought the mule back, and he's going to use him as his forecaster and his predictor. And folks, we've had jackasses in Ottawa ever since.
Roars Expo, Canada, the largest equine trade show in Western Canada at Westerner Park, Red Deer, Alberta, April 15th to 17th, 2022. A trainer showdown as three outstanding horsemen start three promising colts, Cade Mills, Jason Irwin, and Trevor Burtis. Great opportunities to learn from some of the finest horsemen and women of the West. A huge trade show with everything from the world of horses. Get all the information at horseexpo.ca or call 833-425-1799. When calving time is underway, picking the music is a little bit easier. So many good songs about that. Like this one, kind of personal, from Rhett Kissel.
It's calving time, I've gotta go. My heart melts like late spring snow. When I'll be back, if God knows, he ain't gonna say. Daddy shoots a look at me. He says I'm a fool to dream a dream that breaks the hearts of so many and takes them far away from their home. Hear it soft and low, and no one could have ever known that the music on the radio would make me who I am. Yeah, right there, that's me. That's exactly where I wanna be, 'cause I've got six strings in. Gotta get out of my system. The bullpen door's wide open. I'm pulling out and I'm high hoping. And it makes it all the worse that I'm leaving home at calving time. I'm gonna miss my home and the farm. I'll miss my family.
From the Spirit of the West, a roundup of issues and events from the world of agriculture.
At the top of page one, it says, so your input costs keep going up, and even if you're in a position to raise your prices, which most ranchers and farmers are not, well, let's get further into this with Gary Crawford.
Take a listen to this comment from an economist and try to figure out who he's talking about.
Labor recruitment is their top challenge. and the industry is dealing with increased operating costs, it does put a pressure on margins.
Fits farmers like a glove, doesn't it? But economist Hudson Real is not with an ag group. He's with the National Restaurant Association, and he was referring to people in the restaurant business, telling a USDA forum that COVID really decimated the industry, and now, just as things are opening up again for restaurants, the wholesale cost of the food they need to buy is rising at a rate not seen in 20 years. Hourly wages they have to pay to retain workers, those are going up at rates not seen in over 40 years. And so,
over 4 out of 5 table service operators report that their profit margins are down.
And Real says restaurant sales figures are starting to climb out of the depths of COVID.
But 2022 does remain a year of transition for the industry going forward.
This is Gary Crawford reporting for the U.S. Department of Agriculture.
The Ontario Superior Court has dismissed an $8 billion class action lawsuit over the federal government's handling of BSE. In a written decision late in January, Justice Paul B. Chabas said Canada was not negligent, as the plaintiffs alleged, in preventing British cattle from coming into the country between 1982 and 1990, implementing a feed ban and monitoring imports from the United Kingdom. One single case of BSE discovered in 2003, as I'm sure you well remember, in a Canadian-born cow resulted in closed borders and effectively shut down trade. And the class action was launched in 2005 and then certified in 2008. And after numerous Zoom hearings through 2021, the judge ruled that the government followed the science available at the time and complied with the World Health Organization for Animal Health guidelines. And he estimated total losses were $5,419 billion, and producers received government assistance worth $4.256 billion. Cattle producers in southwestern Saskatchewan who lease provincial agricultural crown land might participate in a project to establish how best to protect critical habitat for species at risk. Cattle C. Christopher, manager of Rangeland Services with the Lands Branch at Saskatchewan Agriculture, told the Saskatchewan Stock Growers Association semi-annual meeting that the research will look at how lands managed by producers are protecting multiple species at risk. And it's the government, the federal government, that designates species at risk and identifies critical habitat. 2 years ago, lessees were notified of any critical habitat within their leases, but plans for engagement sessions were stalled because of COVID. Well, it is sure going to be fun to get back on the road again. We'll be heading for Horse Expo Canada at Westerner Park in Red Deer, Alberta, April 15th to 17th, where I'll have the best seat in the house behind the mic for the Trainer Showdown. And there's a lot of world-class clinicians there and a huge trade show. You can get all the information at horseexpo.ca. And for tickets, you can call 1-833-425-1799. And then we'll be heading for the long-awaited Concert 83 at the Lido in Fort St. John with the Western Spirit Band along with Tom Cole and friends, and that is scheduled for June the 3rd. And stay tuned for more information on tickets on that one. And then right after that, a big concert with the band in our backyard to kick off our farewell Spirit of the West cruise to Alaska. And then in August, we'll be at the 30th anniversary edition of the Stony Plain Cowboy Gathering, along with folks like Tom Cole, Doris Daly, Ed Brown, Stuart McDougall, Ryan Fritz, and lots more. And for tickets, you can call 780-718-5379. That is August 12th to the 14th. And the next regular cattle sale at the BC Livestock Co-op is March 26th, then April 19th. It's the 47th Vanderhoof All Breeds Bull Sale, and on April 14th, the 85th Annual Williams Lake Bull Sale. And over the mountains at the Innisfail Auction Market, regular cattle sales, of course, every Wednesday. And on April 17th, it's the Danes Cattle Bull and Heifer Sale. Get all the information at InnisfailAuctionMarket.com or call Mark, Dwayne, or Danny at 1-800-710-3166. Okay, now the final item. We had a great visit with Rod and Terry recently. That's one of our sons and his wife who dropped in for a meal and an overnight stay. And when they left, Billy and I started talking about something that, I don't know, we tend to avoid the subject sometimes, updating our wills. And Billy asked me what one of my wishes might be, and I said, well, tell you what, at my funeral, take that bouquet of flowers from my coffin and throw it into the crowd to see who's next. And that's the Rangeland News. Coming up in the Urban Saddles and Western Wear Horse Training File, some great gems of wisdom from the notes of Buster McLaury, when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. Coming up on the Urban Saddles and Western Wear Horse Training File, a look at some of the gems of wisdom from the notebook of Buster McLaury. But first, way up north, to Alaska, way up north, to Alaska, north, to Alaska, I don't know, the rush is on. Here's an updated version on our Spirit of the West farewell cruise. After 19 years of hosting the finest people you could ever meet in some of the most amazing places you could ever be, Billy and I will be stepping back after this one, and we really want to make it two things: simple, uncomplicated, and the best experience you can have. We love Alaska and all it has to offer. Cruising the spectacular Inside Passage, touring Juneau, historic Skagway, and the amazing Red Dog Saloon, and trying to get the guys to come back out of there. The White Pass Rail Tour on the Trail of the Gold Rush. Lots of live Western music, stories, cowboy poetry, sing-alongs, and so much more. And we'll kick it all off with a special show with the amazing Western Spirit Band right here at the McLennan Ranch. And then we take you to spectacular Sun Peaks, where we spend the night, then down to the ocean for a night in a spectacular waterfront hotel before boarding the luxurious and brand new Holland America Koningsdam. Now this is important. If you would like to join us, please reserve your spot as soon as possible by calling 1-800-530-0131. Sure hope you can come along and share in the good time.
Now it's time for the Horse Training File, brought to you by Irvine Tack and Western Wear, Canada's largest Western store.
Start thinking spring with help from Canada's largest Western store. That's right, spring stock is arriving at Irvine Tack and Western Wear. See what's new and start suiting up with the latest from the biggest names in the biz. Boulay, Ariat, Wrangler, Cinch, Huey, and more. Jeans, jackets, boots, shirts, hats, hoodies, it's all here at Irvine's, exit 305 off Highway 2 by Crossfield, or shop online at irvines.ca.
Don't just wear it, live it. Irvine Tack and Western Wear.
I dug into Buster McLaury's notebook for the Horse Training File today, and here are some of the gems of wisdom that Buster had written in there. When you really hurry a horse or a cow, you just get to the wrong place faster. A horse has to be straight to stop, and has to stop before he can turn around. And if a horse ain't smart enough to know the difference between roping and cutting, you ain't gonna win nothing on him anyway. That is actually from Matlock Rose. And the first time you ride a horse, he'll cost you money. The second time, he'll hold his own. And the third time, he's on the payroll. And that one came from Ray Hunt. Some people just ain't got no natural to them. They'd pet a dog against the hair. And there's a lot of difference between holding a roundup and just sitting between the cows and on the backside of the pasture. That's from Buster, too. And some people try to go fast and make up for not having things right with their horses. From Ray Hunt. And I like this one. I can tell a good cowboy by the way he approaches a cow. And this one, there ain't no kind of feed you can put on a horse to make him a good horse. You've got to catch him and saddle him and ride him. And a good deal is only good if it's good for both parties. And if you're going to gather wild cattle, you got to get wilder than the cattle are. And if it was easy, anybody could do it, and everybody would want to. And I like this one, too. A cow has to have time to think and room to turn around. That's from Buster. And I like this one, too. A herd of cattle ought to leave the roundup ground the same way they leave the bed ground, paired up and walking. And this one, finally from Buster, there are a lot of good, real good times to give a horse a good leaving alone. And for Irvin Saddles and Western Wear, that's the horse training file. And I would pass this gem along with you as well. That daily feeding of Hoffman's Horse Ration sure can help your horses. And you can find out what's in it at hoffmanshorseproducts.com. The 2022 Top Gun Spring Horse Sale runs April 9th at the CalNash Event Center, Ponoka, Alberta. This is the best place to find your next grade horse for any discipline. Ranch horses, team penners, all kinds of rope horses, kids horses, horses for mounted shooting, trail riding, and more. A 100% live auction, come one, come all. Preview is April the 8th at 5 p.m. Sale Saturday, April 9th at high noon. Internet bidding is available as well. Check the catalog to get set up to bid online in live time. For more information, call Jordan Dodds, 403-783-0246. Contemporary cowboy and singer Colter Wall spent most of the winter doing ranch work and writing songs because the COVID restrictions pretty well made it impossible for him, or any of us for that matter, to do any live public appearances. That seems to be changing, though. Let's hope so. And speaking of Colter Wall, he's still a young guy. And you've got to admit, there just is something about that boy.
I cut through the Rockies like some unholy blade. The icy depths of the Pacific I have bathed. Wherever I wander, wherever I stray, the rustle wheat fields start calling my name, calling my name. Let me die in the country that I love the most. I'm a plain-to-see plainsman, and this I will boast. Heart that lies far from the east or west coast. This plain to see plainsman is longing for home, longing for home. Well, the North folk are dandy, they don't mind the cold. The South has filled up both my belly and soul. I know when I'm gray and I know when I'm old. These bones will cry out for the place they were born, the place they were born. Let me die in the country that I love the most. I'm a plain to see plainsman, and this I will boast. My heart it lies far from the east or west coast. This plain to see plainsman is longing for home, longing for home. I met beautiful women, a pleasure to see. Road-bitten bikers and barefoot hippies. Junkies and saints on my travels I'd greet. Far too few a homesick young plainsmen like me. Plainsmen like me. let me die in the country that I love the most. I'm a plain to see plainsman, and this I will boast. My heart, it lies far from the east or west coast. This plain to see plainsman is longing for home, longing for home.
Boy, getting a chance to spend some time with a long time professional, consummate working cowboy like Buster McLaury is sure a treat for me.
Gosh, rope and wrecks, I imagine you were involved in one or two over the years.
I've been in a couple. I've seen quite a few. The good Lord took pretty good care of me. I never had any, I guess, I don't, depending on your definition of bad, I never got hurt roping very bad, so I've been pretty lucky that way. But yeah, when, you know, you tie a 1,000-pound saddle horse and a 1,000-pound cow together, running wide open, there's a lot of things can happen.
Yeah, that's for sure.
Not all of them good.
No. Ever have any of them go over top of you or over on you?
No. I've had a couple of horses jerk down, just a couple, and I can't think of one right offhand. But them horses, they learn to adapt. They learn to take that jerk, you know. So that was always a big deal in our country, a horse that would and could take a jerk, because, yeah, well, they would get some good ones, you know. We wasn't always roping on the flat and open.
That's right. Yeah, they hit the end of that rope. Come around on there.
Be going down the side of a hill or just fixing it, run off a bluff or something.
Roping bulls sometimes.
Yeah, roping. Yeah, we'd always have to go back. There'd be, you know, a certain number we'd have to go back and catch when they're picking bulls up there. And that was always serious business, you know, roping a bull. You don't go on a bronc and dally. You ride your best horse in town and be prepared for kind of whatever might come along, because it's liable to come along.
So yeah.
It was all serious business, roping bulls. It wasn't just for fun.
Yeah, that's for sure. What kind of bloodlines in the cattle in that part of Texas now?
Nowadays a lot of black-hided cows, Angus and Hereford Cross and Brangus and Hereford Cross. When I was growing up, the 60s was, you know, a straight Hereford outfit, and a lot of Hereford cattle in that country. But you're seeing a lot more Bremer influence in the last 30 years, simply because they'll use that old rough country a little better than those Hereford cows.
Yeah. Texas Longhorn blood?
No, we didn't have any of that. It was all, you know, really, really good commercial Hereford cows. They'd really worked on that, you know, since they had Hereford cows, I guess. So they had as good a herd of commercial Hereford cows as it was anywhere.
Okay, and I'll let you go grab some lunch, but we'll visit for more for sure, okay. Buster. So thanks for doing this.
You bet. Thank you.
Well, still to come is this week's classic Song of the West, and it'll be a tip of the hat to Buster. And then the one and only Red Steigall, a cowboy poet laureate of Texas, with a poem that'll keep you listening and guessing right until the end, when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. Red Steigall has a piece of cowboy poetry that tells an amazing story, and we'll tip the golden Stetson today to Buster McLaury, because this classic Song of the West could be about him. Here's Michael Martin Murphy.
I am the Texas cowboy from Texas, now I hail. Give me your open pony, I'm ready for the trail. I love the road and prairies, they're free from care and strife. Behind a herd of longhorns, I'll journey all my life. When early dawn is breaking and we are far away, we fall into our saddles, we round up all of day. We rope, we brand, we earmark, I'll tell you we are smart. And when the herd is ready for Kansas, then we start. Texas cowboy, as brave as I can be. I'm a little Spanish pony, I roam the wide prairie. My trusty little pony is my companion true. Through creeks and hills and rivers, he's sure to pull me through. When threatening clouds all gather and the hurting lightning flash, heavy raindrops splatter and rolling thunders crash. What keeps the herd from running, stampeding far and wide? It's the cowboys with a long whistle and singing by their side. Kansas City, our boss, he pays us up. We lope around the city, we take a parting cup. We bid farewell to city life, from noisy crowds we come. Range back to near old Texas, the cowboy's native home. Hey, I'm a Texas cowboy from Texas, now I am. Give me a rope and pony and I'm ready for the trail. I love the rolling prairies, so free from care and strife. Behind a herd of longhorns, I'll journey all my life.
Horse Expo Canada, the largest equine trade show in Western Canada at Westerner Park, Red Deer, Alberta, April 15th to 17th, 2022. A trainer's showdown as three outstanding horsemen start three promising colts, Cade Mills, Jason Irwin, and Trevor Burtis. Great opportunities to learn from some of the finest horsemen and women of the West. A huge trade show with everything from the world of horses. Get all the information at horseexpo.ca or call 833-425-1799. You know, I think Red Steigall recently won a Wrangler Award for his RFD TV show Somewhere West of Wall Street, and that was well-deserved. I was really hooked on this story, and I think it's a great fit for the Cowboy Poetry Spotlight today, Red's poem that he calls Boley.
The first time I met Boley, I was 7, maybe 8. He had sold my dad a set of longhorn steers. About the time that school was out, I helped him brand his calves, and I worked for Boley 6 or 7 years. He traded for a pinto colt the day that I turned 12. He helped me break him, taught me how to ride. And after that, I dogged his footsteps everywhere he went. He couldn't lose me even if he tried. Now, Boley rode the finest horses I had ever seen. He never seemed to keep them very long. He'd trade them off and leave a while and bring some new ones home, and I never dreamed he was doing something wrong. We lived in Palo Pinto, and his place was south of town. He branded lots of cattle every spring. I often thought it funny that he didn't own a cow. But I kept quiet and didn't say a thing. He had an army contract, and he sold the neighbors some, and yet each year his steer herd multiplied. All those years he's stripping bull calves off the neighbors' cows. My daddy told me after Boley died. I was sitting on the courthouse lawn with Bert and Billy Joe. Their folks was testifying at a trial. My daddy and the sheriff asked if Boley was in town. I said, no, sir, he's been gone for quite a while. Well, early that next morning, they all gathered at our house, and they held a secret meeting in the den. I hunkered down outside the door and listened to them talk, and they were saying bad things about my friend. The sheriff said that Boley was a rustler and a thief. He'd stole some calves from Mr. Slaughter's herd, and last week he took a gelding from a man in Fredericksburg. They're lying, and I don't believe a word. Well, I saddled up my pinto and rode out to Boley's place. I got to let him know they're on his trail. I figured I'd go with him all the way to Mexico. I never thought I might wind up in jail. Boley's place was empty except for one horse in the barn, a sorrel mare he used to let me ride. From the looks of things, he hadn't been at home for several days. I left a note before I walked outside, and then I saw the posse as they raced across the hill. Boley out in front, a-riding hard. He slid his pony to a stop and got off next to me, then raised his hands as they rode in the yard. Now, if I hadn't been there, Boley might have got away. His horse was yet responding to the quirt, and he knew that I admired him, and I'm certain that he sensed I might do something stupid and get hurt. Well, his trial didn't last too long, was too much evidence. They hung him on July 23rd. I was in the front row, and his eyes locked into mine. He ducked his head and didn't say a word. Boley had a lot of friends who came to say goodbye. I went to pay my last respects, of course. My daddy said, one thing for sure, he has always mounted good. It's a shame it had to be a borrowed horse.
Well, thank you so much for taking time to ride along today. And as always, thanks to our great support crew, Mark and Kathy McMillan. And be sure to check the latest issue of Canadian Cowboy Country Magazine. Oh, it's got some terrific reading, and I sure hope you can check out our YouTube channel for videos of this show and a whole bunch of our past programs there, and much more. The links to that and the podcast where you can download the show and take it along are all on our website, hugh-mclennan.com. Till next week, I'm Hugh McLennan. Hope to see you down the trail somewhere real soon.